propel me to my next level. Shout it in this last quarter. I am going to be airlifted to my next level. Say, let the word of God translate me from a level of inferiority into a level of superiority. Say, after this morning, my life, my destiny, my future will shine. Shout it, will shine. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Put your hands together. Whilst we are upstanding, let's appreciate the first lady of the house. Put your hands together. Let's appreciate mommy. Hallelujah. Let's put our hands together and appreciate our resident pastor and the pearls. Put your hands together. Very powerful ministration. Amen. Glory to God. You may be seated. I think the rains has delayed the takeoff of service a bit. You know, so I'm left with about 20 minutes, you know, to close the service. But we'll see what the Lord will do. See, I hear. This morning, I'm starting a new series. I've titled Five Personalities of Foolishness. Five Agents of Foolishness. See, I hear. See, in my lifetime, shout it vehemently, in my lifetime, I will never be foolish. Say it like you mean it. In my lifetime, I will never ever be foolish. Shout it, the spirit of foolishness will never, ever. If you don't say it, you won't be delivered. Say from today, in my lifetime, the spirit of foolishness will never and ever have its way into my glorious life. I refuse to be a fool in the name of Jesus. Shout it in the name of Jesus. You know, in the Sundays to come, I'm going to be showing us, you know, how certain individuals exhibited foolishness that caused them their destinies. Are you with me at all? You see, it's a subject that you need to really pay attention to, because we'll soon discover contemporary examples of, like I said, people who evinced foolishness and how, you know, it can admonish you and I from repeating the same mistakes. Are you with me at all? So this subject is very vital. Tell somebody it's very vital. Tell somebody it's very, very vital. Everybody must wonder, or everybody must look out for the way, you know, you can escape foolishness. Are you with me at all? Because foolishness is a common denominator to everybody. Everybody, if you don't guard your heart, if you don't guard your spirit, you can end up in foolishness. And you will discover a lot of people ran into foolishness headlong in the Bible, and their destinies were exterminated. I pray tonight, I mean this morning, that by the time the meeting is over, any area of your life foolishness has hijacked, may God free you in the name of Jesus. I say, may God free you in the name of Jesus. I have also realized that some people are poor, not because God despised them, not because God hates them. The reason why some people are poor is not even because of a witch or a wizard. They are only poor because they have exhibited foolishness. You can never prosper when you are under the whims and caprices of foolishness. Are you with me at all? Are you in the house or you have gone? I've not even taken over. You are quiet. Listen, I have no shadow of dubiety that God is giving us this message, timely message, at such a time like this, because we need it. Tell somebody we need it. Tell somebody we need it. Ask your neighbor, do you need deliverance from foolishness? Ask your neighbor, do you need deliverance? You see, God told me that foolishness is a disease. Tell somebody, foolishness is a disease. In fact, foolishness is worse than some of the notable diseases we know around us. Because with every disease, medically, with every disease, you know, it can be healed. There is a way God has given man wisdom to deal with some of these diseases. But when it comes to the matter of foolishness, you cannot, you know, there's no medical prescription that can deliver you from foolishness. So it's a disease that cannot be healed. I'm telling you, foolishness is worse than HIV. No, I'm telling you, because these days, if you have money, you can, there's a way they can give you some medication that can prolong your life. But when it comes to foolishness, there is no medication. Are you with me at all? You know, the angel told Lot and the family, he said, escape immediately for your life. When God was about to destroy Sodom, he came to Lot and the family. He said, escape. Today I prophesy. As I teach on foolishness, may God give you grace to escape it. I said, may God give you grace to escape it. He told Lot and the family, he said, escape for your life. Why? Because God was about to destroy Sodom. And you remember when the angel told Lot and the family to escape, one of the things they said was, when you are going, don't look back. It was a very elementary instruction, very simple instruction. Get out of this city. Why? Because of the atrocities, because of the iniquities, I'm going to burn this city down. So you and your household, get out of here. That sounds very simple. Are you with me at all? And yet when they were going, the wife decided to look back. That's foolishness. Are you with me at all? God said, I am delivering you from untimely demise. Just go forward. Don't look back. But some way, somehow, and that's how a lot of people behave. When God says, go this way, you are going contrary. It's a sign of foolishness. You see, the thing about foolishness is that the victims of foolishness, they don't know themselves. I'm telling you the gospel truth. When you are apprehended by foolishness, you that is exhibiting foolishness, you don't see it. Most of the time, the people that see foolishness are the observers, are the spectators. Let me give you a classical. Well, it's a joke, but let me give you an example. 2 days ago, my kids were going to school. Nana and Isley came to the room. And we're having, you know, this kind of, I was joking, behaving like a lady so that they would laugh. Are you with me at all? I was doing things like that, you know, trying to walk like a lady, talk like a... Isley looked at me. She said, Daddy, I don't like it when you do those things. It's not nice. I said, okay. I was still making them smile, happy. Mommy was there. Jada was not there. I was still doing it. Immediately, I heard her coming. I said, let me try and do something for her to also see. But immediately she opened the door. She said, are you crazy or what? In other words, are you foolish or what? How can a full grown man be behaving and talking like a girl? So even that 3-year-old child, when she recognizes foolishness, she can see. Are you with me at all? Before she came, in my mind, I thought I was doing something to make her laugh. So I didn't know I was a fool at that juncture. Are you following me at all? But when she entered, though I was joking, are you with me? She said, what kind of foolishness is this? 3-year-old. That's what I've said in this church. Anytime somebody says you were a fool, don't react. Check yourself. If you are in that state of foolishness, you better go and tell the person thank you. Because when we go into scriptures, you will see the consequences of foolishness. Because in most cases, the consequences could be very calamitous. Very, very inimical. And that's why I'm praying in this last quarter, a lot of prophecies have gone ahead of you. May foolishness not terminate your prophecy. I said, may foolishness never terminate your prophecy. Somebody shout, I will not be a fool. If you don't say it, we'll leave you behind. Shout it, I will never be a fool. So when you are in that state, you don't see it. Are you with me at all? You don't see it. I pray for you that in this last quarter, may God surround you with people that when you are entering foolishness, they will admonish you, they will caution you, they will deliver you from that state of foolishness. Somebody shout, I will be delivered. If only Lot's wife had paid attention to the instruction, she would not have become a pillar of salt. Historians are still telling us that where she became a pillar of salt is still there. It's still there. The only day it will be destroyed is when, you know, like 2 Peter said, when God rains fire to destroy the whole world. One day this world will be destroyed with fire. all our beautiful cars, our houses, everything will be destroyed with fire. That is when that pillar of salt will come to an end. It's still there. Are you with me at all? That's why he said, when he came to them, he said, escape. Maybe the angel had some insight that one of them has the spirit of foolishness. So let me just tell them, live for your life. Live for your life. But she was still wondering, my gas cooker. You know, my rice. I didn't finish it. So she decided to look back. And that was the end. Some people are suffering today because they couldn't obey simple instructions. Simple. No, check yourself. Some of the blunders you have made, it's not because God didn't warn you. God wants us in diverse ways. Sometimes in the preaching of the word. Some you come to church, God says, don't enter fornication. Don't commit adultery. Say, for what? Why? Then you go and sleep with somebody, you get up with HIV/AIDS. And this could have been avoided. Are you with me at all? Don't go and sleep with that brother. Go and sleep with, you go and sleep. You have gonorrhea. That kind of gonorrhea. If you come to me for healing, I won't pray. I will let you keep it for a very long time. Why? Because you disobeyed very simple instruction. I'm just giving introduction. Listen, anointing can heal any disease. See, I hear. Anointing can heal what? It can heal cancer. It can heal HIV. It can heal gonorrhea. It can heal any of these deadly terminal diseases. But one thing anointing can heal is foolishness. Do you know why I say that? Because even the anointed can be a fool. Anointing cannot heal foolishness. Because the one that is the carrier of anointing can still be very foolish. That's why this subject is very vital. Listen, until Jesus returns, the only sure way to escaping foolishness is the undiluted word of God. The only thing that can exterminate foolishness in your heart and, you know, insulate you against cataclysmic attacks is the word of God. I prophesy today, as I preach this undiluted word, any area foolishness is hiding, may God's word expose and free you. I said, may God's word expose it and free you. Somebody shout, I shall be delivered by God's word. Listen, without the word of God, you can never be free totally from foolishness. God's word is the sure way. Tell somebody it's the sure way. It's the only way. It's the only way you can be free from foolishness. Listen, when it comes to foolishness, number one, you must identify the area of your life you are foolish. Because foolishness is not necessarily an all-rounder. There are some people who are very magnanimous. They are very kind. You know, when it comes to give, they give. When it comes to tithe, they tithe. When it comes to offering, they give offering. They are very merciful. But there is another area of their lives, they are very foolish. So you can get it right in certain areas, but there are other areas you are foolish. And that's the area the enemy holds you on and fights to frustrate your future. So when we say foolishness, it may not necessarily be every area of your life. Tell somebody, it's not an all-rounder. You know, there are some people, when they are angry, the way they react will tell us they are foolish. But the same person could be very educated. The same person, you know, could be a very good giver. Very sweet lady, very nice gentleman. There's no doubt about that. But when he is angry, that is when his foolishness emerges. So it may not necessarily be every area of your life, but there are certain areas of your life. You are in a compound house. When you have a problem with one person, the whole compound, everybody will hear, is foolishness. The thing about foolishness is that it's a spirit. It has no iota of respect for title. No respect for position. No respect for status. No respect for gender. Hear me. You can be a general overseer like me, and yet you are foolish. Oh, we see it all over the place. That's why these days there are occupants of the pulpit who can do things. And you wonder, is this wisdom? Are you with me at all? The things that are trending lately, it's a sign that there are occupants of the pulpit who are very foolish. So you can be a head pastor and very foolish. You can be an associate pastor, very foolish. You can be head usher and very foolish. You can be leading praise and worship, but very, very foolish. So your gift does not exempt you from foolishness. Gift ends on earth. You can be a wife and very foolish. You can be a husband. You are very foolish. Why? Because you have allowed certain areas of your life for foolishness to dominate. I pray today that if it is foolishness, is the reason why you are not going forward today, may God terminate it by fire. I say, may God terminate it by fire. So this thing is serious. God says, don't drink alcohol. It's not good. It will destroy your liver. It will destroy your kidney. It's not good. Don't do it. But you still go and drink it. It's a sign you are a fool. God said, any man that sleeps with a woman you are not married to, you are not wise. I didn't say it. He says, any day I decide to go and sleep with a lady I am not married to, Kingsley, you are anointed. You can prophesy. You can preach. But Kingsley, I'm telling you, you are the greatest fool. That's what God is saying. So any day you commit fornication, just know you are a fool. In capital letters. I'm teaching Bible. Small misunderstanding with your husband. You can look at him and say, you think you're a man. Hey, can you create a human being? Small misunderstanding with your wife. You are insulting your wife. If not me, would they call you Mrs.? People want to know. Because you are the greatest fool. Are you with me at all? Can you create a human being? We are what we are by the grace of God. Go and check 1 Corinthians 15:10. So what are you that you are boasting of? It is God. A man can receive nothing. What can you have if God didn't give you? So now God has made you superior in a certain sense. You are using that against your spouse. Is it her fault that she's not educated? Is it her fault that she can't speak grammar like you? Is it her fault that she's handicapped in certain areas? As a husband that has wisdom, you are the one to encourage her. You are the one to say, let me enroll you. Let me take you through some training so that you can become better and have dominance in that area. A man or a woman that is not talking like that, it's a sign that foolishness is hanging around your roof. Give somebody a high five. Tell the person, be wise. Tell the person, if you are quiet, you are a suspect. Allow God's word to terminate foolishness. Allow God's word. Allow what? Hey. If you be honest with yourself, sometimes even you can behave in a certain way. And when you are left alone, you yourself, you'll be saying, Kai. I didn't say no. No, be honest with yourself. Haven't you been there before? In your case, God, no, be anywhere. But you yourself, you are judging yourself. You can't tell. So I said, I overreacted. The way I conducted myself. Later, you'll be asking people, what do you think? You want them to tell you. Once you are, your conscience is saying what you think, it's a sign that you behave foolishly. Is somebody following me at all? When people come around and say, oh, yeah, they want to be chawa drink. They want to be kawa drink. It's not a good thing. No. They are leading you into the apostasy of foolishness. Hey. Oh, yeah. I like my intro. I like my intro. And I said, why uncomfortable? It means the message is working. Yes, so it means the message is sinking. It's entering your spirit. It has to enter your marrow and your bones. I want it to pierce you. I pray today that God will deliver House of Consecration. From the head pastor to the last person, any area of foolishness is knocking. May God deliver us by fire. I say, may God deliver us by fire. Rise up and shout, I will never be foolish. See now, the first person God told me in the Bible that was very foolish was Potiphar. Somebody shout Potiphar. Potiphar. God said Potiphar was a very foolish man. I pray God doesn't describe you like that. See, I hear. Potiphar. In fact, when God told me Potiphar was a fool, I said, sir, I used to admire this chap. In fact, I used to like Potiphar for one thing, because he was one of the few people that could see. Potiphar had the gift of seeing. He has spiritual sight. But God said, he's a fool. That's when I realized from God's perspective that you can be gifted and yet you are a fool. You can preach powerfully. People are jumping, screaming, and in the eyes of God, you remain a fool. Be serious. You can be MD and yet you are a fool. You can be a proprietress, headmaster, and yet you are a fool. What is school? Because I'll show you how I was shocked when God said Potiphar is a foolish man. And you will discover that there are areas of your lives that looks like Potiphar. Give me Genesis 39. Let's read from verse 1. Sit down. Take it easy. Just want to take it easy. I think I'm preaching. I see 320 of you by next week Sunday. I see you driving your car. I take it. Somebody will get married before end. This is the message. I like it because I pray that all of us will take cues from what I'm teaching, so that God will heal us, so that God would deliver us. The Bible said he sent Psalm 107 verse 20. He sent forth his word. He sent forth his word. And his word healed them. Not necessarily of tuberculosis, cancer, high blood. No. Healed them from foolishness. Healed them. He sent forth his undiluted word. He said, I am far from where you are. I may not come to your house in Medina. Come to your house in Tama. Come to your house in Jolu. But I can send my word to deliver you from foolishness. As you are receiving God's word, may God deliver you from foolishness. I said, may God deliver your house from foolishness. Somebody shout, I receive it. And Joseph was brought down to Egypt. And Potiphar, what? Can you see the kind of position he held? He was a big boy. Captain of the guard. And what? Egyptian. Bought him of the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down thither. Continue. And the Lord was what? And he was in the house of, who was the master? Good. Go to the next verse. And his master did what? I prophesied this morning that God will help somebody to see. Before end of this year, may God show you road. May God show you the pathway to success. Receive that impartation. Receive that grace. Somebody said, I take it by fire. Potiphar saw. Hear me. If life will be sweet, you must be a seer. He saw something. Listen, if God doesn't open your eyes, you will not see the friends that are coming to you as helpers and the friends that are coming to you as destroyers. I prophesy today, anybody coming to you as a destroyer, we hurt them by fire. Your amen is looking for my trouble. Anybody they have deployed from the camp of the devil to frustrate your destiny and your future in this last quarter, may the fire of God stop them. I say, may the fire of God stop them. Anybody God is also bringing into your life to celebrate you, to cushion you into your prophetic destiny, receive them by fire. I said, receive them by fire. Somebody said, I take it by fire. Listen, it's not everybody giving to you that is for you. You hear what I said? Not everybody that is giving to you is for you. Don't forget this. There are people who are wolves, but they are pretending to be sheep. I pray that this last quarter, Anybody that is a wolf in your life, laughs with you, eats with you, you confide in, you share destiny matters with, after today, may God separate them from your life. I say, may God separate them from your life. It doesn't matter how many years the person has been with you. If God decides that today the person must go away from you, God will send the person out of your life. Close friends destroy each other. That's what the Bible said. It said, close friends destroy each other. I didn't write it. So if God doesn't open your eyes, who you are calling a friend could be a wolf, but you don't know. So if God doesn't help you to see, like Potiphar saw, you will make a lot of mistakes. Some people have asked people to be their bridesmaid. Meanwhile, that was the wolf in their lives. Some people have asked people to become best man, and they don't know that best man is the demon in your life. I've prophesied to a young lady. I said, your greatest problem, why you can't conceive, is the lady that followed you when you were getting married. Your maid of honor. So they do it. It's the reason why for 10 years you are married, no child. So imagine if she didn't meet me or another kind of a man of God who will reveal some of these things. She will be praying amiss. You know why sometimes our prayers don't get answered? Because we are praying wrong prayer.
Yeah. Yeah.
The Bible said the axe is laid to the root. When you discover where the problem is coming from, you cut it off.
Yeah.
Then you can break through.
Yeah.
But when you pray amiss, you don't even know what you are praying. It's like you are beating the wind. Same person that followed you, cleaning your face. I said, anytime she was cleaning, you remember? I said, remember when she was cleaning off, every now and then she would just touch your tummy. It was the way she was taking your womb. That is wickedness. And this is a friend for over maybe 15 years. Before you make somebody your bridesmaid, it must be somebody you trust. So some people are here, they have trusted wolves, but they don't know. But today, may God open your eyes. I said, may God open your eyes. I said, that's the problem. She was crying. He said, how can she do this to me? Blah, 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 blah. I said, leave all those nonsense. How can, are you? Even Jesus, they crucified him. You are here talking, how can they do this to me? Yes, you can pope. So God must open your eyes. Are you with me at all? God must open your eyes. A couple divorced in UK. After many years of marriage, the man discovered that the wife, every time she said, I mean, you know, abroad, some will work in the morning, come back in the afternoon, get some. You know how it is outside. He didn't know every night when he's going to work, the wife too says, I'm going. She was doing prostitution for many years. He was living with a prostitute. If God doesn't open your eyes, how will you know? How will you know? Because we have two kinds of prostitutes, the psychedelic one and the natural one. Yes, we have classical psychedelic prostitutes. They don't stand by road. The normal ones, they stand by road. The classical one, they have pictures in top hotels. That's the kind of job the wife was doing. If God doesn't open your eyes, you won't know. You think you are the only one left going. Others people are going to. If God doesn't open your heart, that's why those of you are going to marry. Say, Lord, open my. Let me see something. Let me know for truth that this one is from God. That's why those of you who like to parade groomsmen, the other one, rather pray about them. Stop using. Okay, wait, then home. This Obama picture, man, picture be effect. I was asking somebody, what informs some of these things? He said, at least, he said, squad, you know, that your mom won't take. I don't have a problem with that too, but at least make sure they carry the right spirit. Go up and saw pictures, yeah, fair. Dupe, of ma, what do you say, yes. No more basso, carry kwana, jingwa. Carry sick a phone, kwan was a sa. Okay, man, mana. What was that going for? Womanizers. No prayer warrior. No, I'm going to do it. and you want your marriage to succeed with this combination and amalgamation of spirits. Listen, people who are planning to marry, spend time praying about all these things. It's important. Don't make the mistakes some other people have made. If somebody can follow you and can deny you conception, it means it's not something you joke with. Pre-wedding photos. There should be pre-wedding prayers. There's nothing wrong with it. It's very, very important. Why? God, help me to see. Help me to see. Listen. To discover, say, there are people around us who don't like good things. There could be very close people in your life. They don't like good things. When you tell them you are traveling, they are not happy. You have a car, they are not happy. You got problems. They just don't. It's not in their nature to embrace good things. I prophesy in this last quarter, anybody in your life that is a wolf, may the fire and thunder of God expose them by fire. If they are in your house, may God expose them. If they are in your office, may God expose them. If they are in your church, may God expose them. So Potiphar saw. The man saw that God was with who? Joseph. Do you know there are some people here, they can see God is in ACM. There are some people here, they know God is in house of consecration. But why are you rebelling? Why are you being disobedient? You can see God is here. And yet what I preach, what I teach, you go out and do contrary. Why? How can you see that God is in a place and yet you are not paying heed to the instructions of that place? Potiphar saw that God was with this man. God is with him. He carries presence. He carries oil. Something is about him. I seen it. I can perceive that God is with him. If you can see God is in me, God is in HCM, why are you being stubborn? Why are you not giving your time? Why are you not making sacrifices? Why are you not defiling rain and still going to church? Because in your office, if it rains, you still go to work. Can you use rain as an excuse not to go to the office? If you have to prepare a sumptuous, palatable meal for your husband to eat after close of work and it's raining heavily, you will still find a way of getting home. Why? Because he's traveled and you promised him by the time he comes, there will be some delicious meal on the table. You will find a way to get there. Even if he comes back and you were late because of the rain, you will still be caught in the kitchen trying to prepare something. Why? Because there is a little effort. Why? Because there is love inside this person. Listen, sometimes I believe, not that I saw in the Bible, the way we handle God and the matters of God, that's why sometimes some things should come to us without struggle, but we struggle to get them. Because when we compare our way of serving God and our sacrifice, our commitment to the days of old, we can't even compare ourselves. Sometimes it looks like we think we are busier than them. But in our case, things have become easy. How many buses did you see in the Old Testament? How many microphones did the Bible talk about? These guys were in ships. Some of them were walking. Why? For the sake of the gospel. You are seeing God in a place. And yet, you are not making sacrifices. You haven't seen God yet. You know why you are not? You are behaving like that. You are still blind spiritually. You are not seeing God in it here. Listen, if you believe God is here, you don't need somebody to cajole you. You don't need somebody to encourage you. Why? Because you can see God in the place. Listen, I don't need you to confirm it. I am convicted God is here. I was telling somebody recently, I said, you, when you came, we saw you. See the level you are now. If God is not here, you won't be at this level. Some of you have become too proud, too pompous. You have soon forgotten from the rock. Where's God heal you from? I pray today, may God send you back to your first love. I said, may God send you back to your first love. The man saw. He saw. Some of you are seeing. God is not with us. Can we build this in 6 months? God is here. God is here. A man of God called me and said, oh boy, it's like you have a lot of rich people in your church. I said, well, we are okay. We are okay. He said, I think you have some billionaires. Don't lie. I said, definitely we'll have billionaires in Jesus' name. Some people can't believe how we're able to do the things we do. Saturday, I took some people to the top. The administrative block. We are on the 10th floor. Some people didn't even know we had gotten to that level. That's the kind of God we have in ACM. We don't have Rolls Royce kind of believers here. Do we have Ferrari kind of believers here? But the things we do is bigger than Ferrari believers. It's bigger than Rolls Royce believers. Why am I saying that? Because God is with us. So if God is with us, where is your commitment? Why are you full of excuses? Listen, any day you stand in the mirror and doing makeup can make you late to church. You are backslidden. No, I'm preaching. Any day ironing your clothes can make you late to church. It's a sign you are backslidden. How can a man see God inside a man and still miss it? It's a mystery. How can you? Potiphar saw. He saw. You are seeing God at work in house of consecration. But you don't invite anybody to church. One member, one soul, since the inception, you have never done one before. But you believe God is here. No, you are blind spiritually. You wake up, you are thinking about your husband, your wife, your children. That's why you think about your business. There is no church in the thought. You are backslidden. You are backslidden. It's possible that's why things are delayed. Why? Because God can't bless a foolish person. Am I teaching at all? Listen, when you read Matthew, thank you, Holy Spirit. This scripture just dropped in my spirit. When you read, there was a parable in Matthew 13. I think the verse 44. A man saw a treasure. A man saw a treasure on a land. In fact, they were digging. And suddenly they discovered, he discovered something. Today we'll call what he discovered oil. He discovered oil. And you know, oil is wealth. Oil is money. Oil is riches. The man discovered some wealth. Then he quickly went, sold every property he had, his cars, his house, everything, and gave it to buy that land. The world would think you were a fool. Somebody would say, what's wrong with you? Why are you making such investment? You see, that parable there is a metaphor. It wasn't talking necessarily about what you saw. It's talking about a man or a woman that attends a church called House of Consecration. You can see God in the place. You can see God at work. God is with his servant. God is in the house. We are powerful associate pastor. We are powerful worshipers. We are powerful team. And yet, you can see that there is oil in that atmosphere. But you are not giving your energy. You are not giving your resources. You are not giving yourself to the vision of the house. It's a sign you don't have wisdom. It's a sign you are gradually entering into foolishness. When the man discovered something good, he sold everything he had. Listen, until you get to that point where you are sold out for this vision, where you are sold out for house of consecration, it's likely you can't enter your next level. Because every man's success is tied to his church. If you don't believe it, then become an unbeliever and stop going to church. Every bona fide child of God, quote me anywhere, your pastor is your gateway to your success. Just as in your office, your CEO or your manager can decide your promotion. In the same way, when God wants to promote you, God uses a servant. I pray in this house, may God give you an unusual appetite to serve. May God give you an unusual appetite to be committed. Receive that impartation. Receive that grace. As your hands are lifted, anywhere foolishness is maneuvering in your life, by thunder, by fire, by God's word, I terminate it by fire. I terminate it by fire. Give me verse 19. Give me verse 19 of Genesis 39. Quickly. Let me round off. And it came to pass. Oh, Jesus. Father, in the last 17 years, I've been preaching. By the grace of God, you have helped me. I pray I will never enter foolishness. That one day somebody will say, we knew him. He was a powerful preacher. He was a great prophet. He was all over the place. But see how he ended up in foolishness. May that never be my portion. I pray for you. That it will never be said of you that you began the journey well, but you ended up in foolishness. May God deliver you in the future. May God deliver you in advance. Somebody shout fire. The same Potiphar that saw that God was with Joseph. You see, Potiphar didn't know God brought Joseph into his house, not to help Joseph, but for Joseph to help him. Joseph was not in Potiphar's house because he needed help. It was Potiphar. God was thinking of the future. God saw the future which Potiphar couldn't see. So I brought you a helper. I brought you somebody. When Joseph was in Potiphar's house, the man was making money. The man was prospering. The man was proliferating. Why? Because there was a Joseph. And even that success, it was a temporal one. Why? God was looking at something colossal, something gargantuan in the future. But Potiphar didn't see. Potiphar thought he was doing Joseph a favor. Maybe you think when you come to church, you are doing me a favor. No. God put me here so that your destiny can be sweet. So when you are coming, stop all this shakara. Don't think you are pleasing me. It is for your own good. It's only a man or a woman that is foolish that would think, I'm going to church because I want to help him. Help me. I can kneel on this altar and say, even if everybody leaves this church, God will still build this church. He said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall never prevail. He said, if we leave, how can he get money? How can he get time? No. He said, if you fail to do that, I will raise up stones. Listen. God is a miracle worker. If fish can produce money, if the Red Sea can divide, there is nothing God cannot do. I pray for you. May the spirit of humility, may the spirit of simplicity enter your life. Receive that impartation. Rise up, shout fire. Shout fire. Shout fire. Yeah. Look at it. And it came to pass when his master heard the words of Mrs. Potiphar, which he spake unto him, saying, after this manner did thy servant Joseph to me, that his wrath was kindled. Listen, people who are ready to perish, they are very irrational. People who are ready to perish, they are very myopic in their thinking. Listen, before you react, go to God first. Ponder over the issue. Lord, what do I do? Because sometimes what your mind is thinking is not what your heart is thinking. Your mind is saying, yeah, baby. But your heart is saying you are bigger than this. Don't listen to your mind. Listen to your heart. They don't always commensurate. Sometimes what your heart and your mind are thinking is parallel. This is a man. Can you see a man that saw God inside somebody? The man had a gift. You came back. Your wife is telling you that this guy tried to rape me. At least you can see. At least you are spiritually sensitive. You need to, don't just accept what you are hearing. That's a man or a woman that has wisdom. That's somebody who can see. Your wife said that. But you have noticed this boy in this house for some time. Could it be maybe this one, your wife has made a mistake? Or could something happen? Even if you were going to throw him. Because eventually he took Joseph and put him in prison. Couldn't you have just said, okay, honey, I will deal with this boy. But because you went to God and God said he didn't do anything. The city is big. There was a way you could have sent Joseph away, not necessarily into jail. Joseph, I know. I mean, since you came to my house, I can see the change. I can see how our business is doing well.
I know, Joseph, I know you didn't do it. I know my wife tempted you. I know. Because every man knows his wife. Every woman knows their husband. If your husband is known for promiscuous life, your husband is a womanizer, and somebody comes to you and say, your husband tried to harass me sexually, my dear, don't pretend. In the presence of the person, you can say, no, my husband cannot do that. But when you are left alone, you know he's more than capable. Because even before he met you, there were cases like that. I was expecting Joseph, Potiphar, to display some level of, erudition. But he just took a decision, irrational decision. Hasty decision. Joseph, you are fully, come here. Put him in jail. See a man. You took opportunity and threw it in jail. Took opportunity, threw it in jail. You are privileged to be in house of consecration. You are privileged to hear a man of God that preaches in season and out of season. Instead of staying to hear God's word that will embellish you, the enemy is looking for a way to send you out so that you will miss your opportunity. Let me abridge the story, because you know the story. Eventually, Joseph went to jail. You know what the Bible said? Even in prison, God was with him. This thing you are playing with, somebody is busy looking for it. This atmosphere we have, somebody is busy looking for it. It's not the building, but the presence in the building. People are looking for a place where they will hear truth. You are hearing truth and you are fighting the truth. You are telling me I shouldn't preach against adultery. I shouldn't preach against telling lies. I shouldn't preach against fraud. Eh? So I should preach what? That you can collect somebody's wife. I'm preaching commitment. I'm preaching end of the year. We have holiness now or never. The last time I preached on rapture. This time I'm preaching on the signs of the end time. It's not every church that preaches those messages. So it's a privilege to be in a place that every year, before the end of the year, you do a personal assessment of your life. You are in that kind of place. You don't want to be there. Some people are telling you, where we are is the job. The job. I'm here collaborate. He took Joseph, put him in prison. God said to me, can you now see he was a foolish man? I brought him privilege. I brought him opportunity. Years ago, when I saw this, I said, God, so is this how a man can end up? May it never happen to me. Shout it, may it never happen to me. Do you know eventually, you know the story. Joseph came out of prison, became prime minister over the same Egypt where Potiphar was. So Joseph now became his ogre. Come on. Can you imagine if the man had used wisdom earlier to send Joseph away, but because God had already prophesied that this guy will become prime minister. So it wasn't shocking to God, but it was shocking to the observers and spectators. If Joseph had become a big man, just imagine the position Potiphar would have enjoyed. But foolishness. After this scripture, we didn't hear of Potiphar again. That's how foolishness can make you to be forgotten. But Joseph became prime minister. I bet you, if Potiphar had handled Joseph well, Joseph would have made him maybe minister for finance. He would have given him a more honorable position than what he was enjoying. But look at it. I'm sure Joseph would say, my servant, sir, go and get me that Potiphar. Then Potiphar comes, sir. But you see, Joseph was not wicked. Joseph was very merciful. That's why till Jesus comes, David will continue to be a man after God's own heart. David had the opportunity to kill Saul. He said, who will lay his hands against God's elect? Sometimes I worry when I see people are undermining. You undermine your pastor, you speak evil of your pastor, and you think you'll go scot-free. Even if me, I don't curse you, God will deal with you. God will deal with you. I'm telling you. The prophet said to Gehazi, did my spirit not go with you? His flesh was there, but his spirit left. Maybe my flesh won't curse you, but my spirit will deal with you. Listen, God is here. Tell somebody, God is here. It's an opportunity God is giving you. It's an opportunity. This is how Potiphar jettisoned his destiny. How may history not forget you because of foolishness? I said, may history not forget you because of foolishness. I prophesy that wisdom will be displayed in your office. Wisdom will be displayed in your marriage. Wisdom will be displayed in your church. Receive that impartation. Receive that grace. Somebody shall fire. If you are in a department like the choir, your leader is Benjamin. In his absence, Anita is in charge. If you are a member of the choir, don't ever have the thought of undermining them. Don't disrespect them. You may not always agree with them, but honor them because God put them in charge. When you go to the instrumentalist, Mr. Kato is there. He has some people there. They have to honor who is in charge. Usher, they have head usher. You must honor them. Look at mommy. Okosuruba form. She's the mother of the church. You can say, I don't care. She will continually be the mother of the church. You must honor the same honor you give me, you must give it to her. Why? Because God is in SCM. Pastor James is your resident pastor. You must honor him. Are you with me at all? Why? Because God is here. It's an opportunity you have. Listen, don't ever think you are doing, don't ever let it cross your head that you are doing ACM a favor. Because on the day of reckoning, it is what you did. And on that day, you will not go and tell God, I did it because of him. I did it because of the... No, you did it so that you can find a good place in heaven. It's a privilege. Don't end up in foolishness. Don't end up. Don't end up. I pray today that husbands will become wise. Wives will become wise. If God is inside your husband, honor him. If God is inside your wife, honor her. Sometimes even your children, God can be hiding inside them. Don't forget, there were many children. God was not in them. There was Judah. There was Simeon. There was Levi. All of them, but God was not in them until Joseph came. God said, this one, I'm inside him. Lift up your hands. Stand to your feet. Say, my father, my father. Shouted, my father, my father. Today, as my hands are lifted, I prophesy, let foolishness leave my heart, leave my spirit, leave my soul. Say, my father, beginning from today, I kick out foolishness. I kick against foolishness. I will never be a fool. I will never repeat Potiphar's mistake. In the name of Jesus, say, Lord, if you brought me to HCM to prosper me, to mold me, to bless me, to promote me, to consecrate me, nothing takes me out by fire, by fire. Say, Lord, any day I am being misled by the spirit of foolishness, let that spirit catch fire, catch fire, catch fire, catch fire. Clap your hands and pray against foolishness. Pray, pray. Paradadadosha, paradadadosha. Paradoxe, paradoxe, Madabadabazia, Zekenebaza de Badabaya, Baladadosa, Yekedebaze, Yete, Maledes, 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 Maledes. In the name of Jesus, lift up your two hands. Say, Lord, in this last quarter, any little area of my life, say, Lord, in most areas, I may be exhibiting wisdom, but that small area of my life, foolishness has hijacked. By the blood of Jesus, by the word of God, Let that small area of foolishness disappear, die, evaporate out of my life by fire, by fire, bonsem ne bonfire. Da 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 shatai. Zeneme zeneme zeneme. Aliba talabasaya. Katalabosye. Yeba da ba da ba da sa. Kara da 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 ya. Ikoye ikoye ikoye. Kabadabosh. 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 Kabadabosh, kadabadabosh, rataya. Morada da 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 da. Morada da 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 da. Morada da 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 da. Shataya, 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 shataya. Imanemos. Imanemos, imanemos, imanemos. Baradede, iledebe, ayadaya. Reba ba 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 ba. Hey, shatata. In the name of Jesus. Look at me. Put the scripture on the screen. We are praying our last prayer. Proverbs 6:32. Proverbs 6:32. Shout it, I'm in this house to be consecrated. Shout it, I am in this house to be consecrated. But whoso committed adultery with a woman is foolish. Is that not what the Bible said? If you don't have understanding, you are a fool. Are you with me at all? Listen, the adultery here can be fornication, can be telling lies, can be disobedience. It can be any of them. Because every one of them I mentioned in the Bible said that in Revelation, it said the last group of people that will enter hellfire are liars. Yeah. So liars have no place in heaven. Adulterous people have no place in heaven. In Galatians, the Bible made it clear, if you are a fornicator, unrighteous man, you can never enter heaven. And it's not because the devil they do you, it's because you are a fool. So any day you commit fornication, you commit adultery, don't blame the devil. Is somebody following me at all? Every sexual sin is premeditated. You will see, even at the juncture where you are going to do proskuneo, something will tell you stop. Won't it tell you? You think when I was dating mommy, I didn't have feelings that when she would come and see me, I would want to. But something tells you are a man of God. Something tells you can't do that. Something tells you no, it's not. Wait on, for the appointed time. When the appointed time came, I exercised myself. See, I hear. Who's always had an YD? Now, message in part one, credit you. But if I'm going to be able. But you see, my concern here is how some foolishness can make you lose out on a point. But if I could have become a big boy, I'm telling you, listen, do you think? If you are close to, let's say, Lawrence, you are the best of buddies to Lawrence. You have helped Lawrence. Lawrence has become a big boy. Now Lawrence has become president. There is no way Lawrence will give you something to do. No, talk to me. You are very close to him. Can Lawrence become president? And when I want him to give me something, he won't give me. Why? Because of the relationship. So that is how foolishness extends somebody's opportunity. I pray for you. You will never make a mistake from today. From today, any little area, foolishness dominated. As my hands stretch, is the hands of Jesus. Foolishness shall disappear forever. I say foolishness shall disappear forever. Put your two hands on your head. Let me pray for you. Father, by the time this series is over, let foolishness disappear. Let us not leave our place, our destiny place, because of foolishness. Let us not. Let my husband not. Let my wife not. Let my children not. Let anybody that is precious to me not. Lord, God is here. There is no doubt. We are convicted about it. We know you are with me. We know you are here. Whatever it takes for our feet to be planted, plant it. Let foolishness disappear from our lives. Let foolishness not make us miss our golden opportunity. You brought us here for a reason. Let that reason be fulfilled. I bless your people today in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Put your hands together. Come on, clap your hands, all you people. Lift up your hands. I feel in my spirit. You are here. You don't know Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior. Close your eyes. You are in this house. Who are them? Who named Jesus? Say, Okra, anyone, Jinkwa. Or probably you are born again, but you are backsliding. You want God to restore you. If you are here like that, I'll pray for you. Come to me quickly. If you want to receive Christ, you want to rededicate your life, that's okay. I'm counting to 10, then I will pray. Father, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I felt in my spirit. You want to rededicate your life? You want to receive Jesus as your Lord? I normally don't do this, but I felt in my spirit that God is giving somebody an opportunity. Come to me very quickly. You may have received Christ already, but you want to rededicate, reaffirm your commitment. Come to me. Close your eyes. Don't look at anybody. Come to me. Come to me. Come to me. This thing is not about individuals. It has everything to do with your salvation. Nobody can tell. Nobody can tell. These days, people sleep and they don't wake up. Not because they were sick. Nobody can tell. If the opportunity comes, you take it by storm. Those of you in front, lift up your two hands with me. To my heart, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, this morning, as I've lifted up my hands, cleanse me, sanctify me, wash me with your blood from the crown of my head to the sole of my feet. From today, my name is written in the Lamb Book of Life. I will not go back to my vomit. I will not go back to the things you have delivered me from. From today, I am your son. I am your daughter. My name will forever remain in the book of life. Any day I die, any day Jesus returns, I will make it to heaven in Jesus' name. Father, I bless them. Keep them. Keep them. Keep them. Strengthen them in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Put your hands together for them. Put your hands together. All right, quickly take your offering. Quickly take your offering. Take your offering. Take your offering very quickly. Take your offering. Take your offering. Father, we bless the offerings as we receive them in Jesus' name. Amen. Quickly rise to your feet. Follow the instructions.